Good morning, Saints. You can tell from the black sky and the pouring rain out there. It is what it is. A couple of announcements as we get started here. The Thanksgiving and Christmas food boxes that we're collecting, Terry is getting plucked out there, and the items that you pick up need to be back by November 15th. If you're watching this, it's probably November 15th, and that means get them in as soon as you can. It's not too late, just get them in as soon as you can. The Blizzard Blitz is going on, and if you have some warm coats, gloves, hats, socks, you can drop those off at the church in the Rubbermaid tub that's out under the portico at any time. We want those items back in by the Sunday, the 22nd. The angel tree is up, but I don't think the ornaments, the angels, are on it yet. So be looking for that. That will come as soon as possible. Wanted to let you know that we have a couple of fun Christmas things on the schedule now. We've recently planned with the worship reopening team, and we've got events planned for December 13th and 20th in the evening, musical events. And so we're looking forward to that. We hope that you all be able to attend. We are not going to have a Wednesday evening recording like this on the week of Thanksgiving. We will have a recorded service for the Sunday following, but we will not meet here on Wednesday evening, the day before Thanksgiving. That's the 25th. And just wanted to take a moment to point out our media page on the website. There are a number of good resources there that I just want to make sure everybody is aware of. We have family Sunday school lessons that are done for our kids and grandkids in the congregation. They are done by members and friends of the congregation and put up every week. There's a new lesson that you can do with your kids or grandkids at home. We have weekly devotionals that go up on Wednesdays for all the saints, and that's generally me talking to you through a camera and hopefully having something useful to say. We have sermons and worship recordings from all the way back since we started this year. And all that stuff, if you check on our media page, you can get to anytime you want. Also, we have online Bible studies going on now on Tuesday morning, Thursday evening, and Sunday morning. So if you want to get involved with one of those, all three of them are studying the Gospel of Matthew. So it's just a matter of which time works best for you. Get in touch with me or with Shelley, and we can connect you with a group. Are there any other prayer concerns or announcements that people want to share today? All right, let's take a moment and prepare our hearts for worship. Thank you. join me in our call to worship. Listen well, friends. The day of the Lord is at hand. Some say the Lord is asleep. He will do neither harm nor good to us. Some have filled the master's house with violence and deception. But those who love the Lord rejoice in his approach. Let us worship God. Let's come to God in prayer. O Lord, you are so far beyond us, beyond space and time, above the clouds, above the heavens, above all that we know, all that we understand, all that we perceive. You are greater. You are more. You are wiser. Your love, your knowledge, your justice, your peace is deeper. O God, help us to perceive you even just a little bit better today. Help us to fix our attention on you, that we might know you more fully and love you more fully. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Friends, we come to God knowing that God is good, God cares for us, God is faithful to us, and yet we are not always so good, we are not always so caring, we are not always so faithful. Trusting in God's mercy, let's turn to God now in confession. Let us pray together. God, beyond time and space, we confess that we do not know how to wait. We expect to have what we want when we want it. We eat fast food. We choose rush delivery. We consume entertainment on demand. We assume the world revolves around us and take for granted all the people who provide our comfort and convenience. We even get annoyed when you don't operate on our schedule. We have been impatient with you, concluding that you have forgotten us when your answers to our prayers don't come immediately. God, forgive us. Help us to slow down, to breathe, and to wait. Amen. Friends, the good news of the gospel is that in Jesus Christ, we are made new. In Jesus Christ, our hearts are reshaped, reformed, reclaimed by God. In Jesus Christ, what has separated us from God is forgotten, it is gone, it weighs upon us no more. In Jesus Christ, you are forgiven today. So the peace of Christ be with you. Now share that peace with one another. Let's come back together now and affirm our faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated.
Let us turn now to the reading of God's Word. As we prepare to listen to Scripture, please join me in the prayer for illumination found in your bulletin. Author of life, let your words give life to our souls today. Let our hearts be filled with your peace, our actions be filled with your truth. May we rejoice in the goodness of your will made known to us. Amen. Our first scripture lesson is from Psalm 90, verses 1 through 12. Lord, you have been our dwelling place in all generations, before the mountains were brought forth, or ever you had formed in the earth and the world from everlasting to everlasting. You our God. You turn us back to dust and say, turn back, you mortals. For 1,000 years in your sight are like yesterday when it is past, or like a watch in the night. You sweep them away. They are like a dream, like grass that is renewed in the morning. In the morning, it flourishes and is renewed. In the evening, it fades and withers. For we are consumed by your anger. By your wrath, we are overwhelmed. You have set our iniquities before you, our secret sins in the light of your countenance. For all our days pass away under your wrath. Our years come to an end like a sigh. The days of our life are 70 years, or perhaps 80, if we are strong. Even then, their span is only toil and trouble. They are soon gone, and we fly away. Who considers the power of your anger? Your wrath is as great as the fear that is due you. So teach us to count our days, that we may gain a wise heart. This is the word of the Lord.
Please be seated. Our second scripture today comes from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 1 through 11. This is a letter that Paul writes to a church in Thessalonica, and he's speaking to people who are awaiting God's return, who have come to Jesus, have come to faith in Jesus Christ, and who expect him to come back. Now that is part of the Christian story, has been for a long time. But Paul, writing to these believers, has some interesting words and wisdom to share. I invite you now to listen for God's word today. Now, concerning the times and the seasons, brothers and sisters, you do not need to have anything written to you, for you yourselves know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. When they say, there is peace and security, then sudden destruction will come upon them, as labor pains come upon a pregnant woman, and there will be no escape. But you, beloved, are not in darkness for that day to surprise you like a thief. For you are all children of light and children of the day. We are not of the night or of darkness. So then let us not fall asleep as others do, but let us keep awake and be sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night. And those who are drunk get drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober and put on the breastplate of faith and love, and for a helmet, the hope of salvation. For God has destined us not for wrath, but for obtaining salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build up each other, as indeed you are doing. Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Well, folks, I regret to inform you that the end of the world is coming. I can tell it's coming because of what I see going on in the world, but mostly I can tell because of what God has declared in Scripture. The end is coming. It's coming. I guarantee it. Now, if I were a certain kind of preacher, this would be where I pulled out my whiteboard or my flip chart and walked you through all these arcane interpretations of ancient prophecy and current events and to demonstrate conclusively and confidently and without a doubt that the world was going to end on, what a random date, February 18th, 2021. And when it didn't, I'd give you a fallback date based on another set of calculations. And when that one didn't pan out either, supposing you still believed me at all, I'd give you another one. I'm not that kind of preacher. I know, however, that those preachers are not without an audience. Probably for as long as any of us can remember, people have been predicting the end of the world. Even if you don't care much for specific predictions, people are continually making big money off the genre of apocalypse. Somebody is buying all those book and film adaptations of the end of the world. I think the reality is we're interested in this topic. We're curious. I mean, the end of the world, Jesus' return, is a big deal. If you know church history, you know that basically every generation since Jesus, Christians have been anticipating the second coming, believing that it was imminent. We are all understandably invested in that return, in the day of the Lord, and naturally we want to know when. When will this happen? Now, the bad news today is I'm not going to answer that question. I can't. I don't know the answer, and I don't tend to trust anybody who thinks they do. Paul said in his letter to the Thessalonians, I really don't need to write anything to you about the timing of this event because you all know that nobody knows. You know that it will come from out of the blue. It'll happen as unexpectedly as a thief in the night with all the suddenness of labor pains. When the people are celebrating Pax et Securitas, peace and security, one of the mottos of the Roman Empire. When the people are celebrating peace and security as if they have everything under control. In this vision, Paul suggests the end will arrive as an interruption right when we've all gotten comfortable. Jesus, who also asserted that he didn't know the day or the hour of his second coming, who also used language about thieves and labor pains, suggests in Luke that the end will be accompanied by evil omens and portents in the sun and the moon. He says, when wars and insurrections, earthquakes, epidemics, and famine are happening, when the earth tilts off its axis and it seems like there's nothing anyone can do to set it right, and hopelessness just abounds, those are the telltale signs. So Paul says to anticipate the second coming when things are going well. Jesus says when things are chaotic and out of control. And I wouldn't blame you if Jesus' vision seems to resonate a little bit more than Paul's right now, but they agree that the one thing you can't do is predict it. They agree that the end will come suddenly and unexpectedly. And insofar as they disagree, I think that only reinforces the point that the day of the Lord is by nature known only to the Lord. We are not in charge of it. There is no way we can know in advance when it will happen. It could come at any time. So the recommendation that both Jesus and Paul give is be ready. Be ready. What does that mean for us? Are we supposed to hear that as the question evangelicals sometimes ask? If you died tonight, would you be ready to meet your Maker? Is readiness for the Lord's return a matter of feeling confident about judgment because we've prayed the right prayer or performed the right actions, or is there something else to it? I think a lot of us have a sense of anxiety or even dread about the second coming. We might think of it primarily as a day of judgment, and we might be worried that we will be judged wanting. Or we might just feel such uncertainty about it. You know, how is it going to change my life? Am I still going to be able to go golfing on Saturday? Watch college football? It might just be so uncertain and so baffling to us that we have a hard time looking forward to Christ's return. And if that's the case, we're going to approach this day with more concern and less excitement, and it's going to be hard for us to be ready as Paul exhorted the Thessalonians. See, for his church, the day of the Lord represents the promise of victory to people who are just trying to hold on in a hard and unforgiving world. It's a day when their fight will be over, when their journey will be complete. It's a day of rescue, when God is going to reach down and pick them up, lift them into his presence. They are a people who've walked faithfully with God. Paul says as much. And their fear isn't really that when the Lord comes back, he's going to be disappointed or upset with them. Their fear is that they aren't going to make it until the Lord comes back. They've been waiting eagerly for Jesus' return ever since his ascension, and they've watched things go from bad to worse in the Roman Empire, and they've seen even some of their loved ones in the church pass away while they are still waiting. They're wondering how much longer they can wait and what happens. What does it mean if we die before Jesus comes back? Paul has a reassuring answer for that. When the day of the Lord comes, those who are dead and in the grave won't miss out. They will be awakened by the trumpets of the angels. They will rise up and meet the Lord first. Those who are still alive will wait until all the dead are raised and welcomed before they can all enter together into the joy of the victorious kingdom of God. And that vision he has of the coming day of the Lord, the second coming of Jesus Christ, is meant to comfort and to encourage those who are waiting faithfully without knowing how much longer they have to wait. So in that context, when Paul tells them to be ready, what he's saying is stay awake. Hold on. Help is closer than you think. It's coming. God has not forgotten about you. God has not forgot about your loved ones. You belong to God, and whatever else happens, your salvation has never been in doubt. So what do we do with that? I mean, what does it mean to be ready for the day of the Lord? Paul has more wisdom to share here. First, we should remember that we belong to the light, not to the darkness. I know some of you are thinking about Pat Benatar. That's okay. But we belong to the light. Daylight is when we are alert and awake. Darkness is when we are asleep. It's when we let down our guard. Daytime is when we work and we can be productive. Nighttime is when we party and unwind. Again, that is not when we're at our most prepared. Light is where we're visible and accountable. Darkness is where we might try to get away with something that we know we shouldn't. Light reveals the truth. Darkness conceals it. Light makes our way clear. Light is safety and certainty and security. Imagine you're driving home at night through an unfamiliar part of town. You've probably got your high beams on because you want to see ahead of you as well as you possibly can. You want to know in advance if there's a sharp turn or if there's somebody drifting into your lane. The light is what you depend on to overcome the darkness. Or perhaps you're walking through a rough neighborhood. You stay in the light of the street lamps as much as you can because you don't want to be taken by surprise. The light is your best defense. Paul says we need to stick to that light. We've already received from God enough light to keep us awake. The good news of God's salvation is the light in which we can work and serve, like those who are living and working during the daylight. We know how the story ends. We don't have to grope around in the dark, unable to see, afraid to move, unsure of the next step. Living in this light, we can move forward in confidence. Second, we exercise vigilance. Notice that Paul's message to the Thessalonians is really more stay ready than get ready. It's not as if they aren't ready. He commends them that they are living in the right way, that they've been prepared for the Lord's return. And basically, he's challenging them to stay that way. You know, ongoing vigilance can be hard. Keeping watch can be hard. Jobs that require you to do nothing but watch are actually kind of exhausting. Police on stakeouts, security guards on their rounds, TSA agents scanning carry-ons hour after hour. It's exhausting. And you wouldn't think so because it mostly involves a lot of sitting around and waiting for something to happen that almost never happens. But it's exhausting because it's just so boring that we can't keep our brains engaged. But when you're on watch, that's exactly what you have to do. If you zone out even for a second, you could miss something, and missing something could spell disaster. So keeping watch, staying vigilant, waiting for something to happen is a challenge for brains like ours that crave stimulus and novelty. To stay ready and to stand watch for Christ's return means, in part, learning how to stay focused even when our spiritual journey is boring. Even when it gets a little monotonous and repetitive. Not every moment of our spiritual life is going to be a mountaintop, exciting moment. Not every moment will be as powerful as a Christmas or an Easter service or the day that we were baptized. Some days are just regular days, ordinary. Some days are even more blah than that. But this is not an excuse for indifference or distraction. If we turn our heads to chase some other shiny spiritual object, we might end up miles down the road in the wrong direction before we realize it. We need constant reminders of the good news, which we get with and through one another. Continue to encourage and support each other in faith, Paul says. So if you struggle to stay focused while standing watch, don't do it alone. Get someone else to stand with you. Finally, the conclusion of this story should give meaning to our story. The time, the place, the reality of Jesus' return, I'll be honest, does not occupy a prominent place in my daily thinking. It's not something that I am super caught up in. I'd assume that the second coming is not really a high priority doctrine for many Christians. It's not a doctrine of immediate significance. You know, it'll come when it comes and when God is good and ready. And there's nothing that we can do to change any of that. But this story is essential as the closing chapter of the gospel story. It is the promise that brings together our whole journey of faith. Reinhold Niebuhr once said that it makes all the difference in the world whether history has an ending or it just ends. You know, it's just a matter of the sun burning out and all of us dying and nothing else happening. The promise of the second coming of Jesus Christ is the affirmation that we are moving forward toward a purpose and a goal, and God is directing history toward that moment when the purpose is realized. In the Christian story, Jesus is the light by which all history will be measured, and his return is necessary to make sense of any of it. You know, there has to be a final judgment and a purification to confirm this moral truth that there is a difference between good and evil, that some things are worth doing and some things are destructive and wrong. Otherwise, it's all relative. It's all just matters of opinion. But God's promise of the coming day of the Lord declares that all of human history has meaning, and it is found in the conclusion of a story that has been planned from the beginning by God. It affirms that our individual lives have meaning and that God's plan for us is not wrath and destruction. It is salvation. So Jesus Christ is coming back for us. We can be confident of that. And he is coming back to make our story and his story one story. We don't know when, we don't know how, but we know that it is in his hands, and at that moment, history will be fulfilled. The Christ who was crucified will stand as the risen Lord over all. Thanks be to God for that good news. Now, friends, we are going to have a time of offering as Joy is going to play, and we are invited to offer to God our hearts, our commitment, our dedication, our trust in God that this is the way the story is supposed to end. He is coming back. He has not forgotten. He has not delayed. But it is happening on his timetable, and it is happening at the right time. Let us turn to God and offer our hearts. us come to God in prayer. God, we know that you are sovereign, you are in control. In a world that often looks like it's out of control, in a world where we are often aware of how little we can control, help us to have trust in your sovereignty. Help us to have patience as we wait for your return, as we wait for the fulfillment of your plans. Help us to remember that you have reasons that perhaps we can't understand, but everything is happening according to your plan. God, help us to have faith that we might work together with you. It's difficult when we feel like things are just beyond us and beyond our ability. We're often tempted to sit back and to hide and to wait passively, to say, okay, God, you take care of it. Remind us that you have work for us to do, that you want us to be involved in the process of turning this world back to good, that you want us to be out seeking the lost alongside you. You want us to be out binding up the sick and the wounded alongside you. You want us to be sharing the pain of those who grieve alongside you. You want us to be rejoicing along with those who celebrate and alongside you. God, in every situation we face, you are present. Help us not to believe or not to be misled into thinking that you are not here simply because we don't recognize the way that you're at work. God, we pray for all those on our prayer list this week. We pray for all those who are stressed out, who are struggling, who are uncertain about their future. We pray for those who are in pain, whether that's a physical pain or an emotional pain. We pray for those who are trying to accomplish things that just seem out of their grasp. God, we pray that you will give them all peace and strength and comfort, that you will remind them of your love and your presence. Hear the prayers, O God, that we lift in speech and in silence now for those who are on our hearts. Thank you, Lord, for listening as your people pray. We join our voices together now in the prayer your Son taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now please rise for our closing hymn. Friends, the bumper sticker says, Jesus is coming back. Look busy. And I know that's a joke, but if I were writing it a little bit more seriously, I would say, Jesus is coming back. Be ready. It's not about how you look. It's not about how you act. It's not about fooling God into thinking that you're something that you're not. It's about being who God wants you to be. Because you don't know when he's coming. Maybe it's today, maybe it's tomorrow, maybe it's 50 years from now, it doesn't matter. If you live today the way that you're supposed to, you will be ready. Now friends, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May he make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May he give you peace. And all God's people say, Alleluia. Amen.
Go in peace.